Good morning, everyone. We'll be talking today about God's relation to his people and how will it affect the move or the act of God towards us, and how should we approach God in the light of what we are going to know or to discover for today's lesson. Please bear with me for a little while, for it will be very important since it deals with our standing before our Creator as his creatures. Thank you. Our topic is God's character in relation to us, of which scope is the attribute of God which is known as immanence. This is in contrary to this attribute of God again, which is the transcendence. So they are total opposites, but both of them are attributes of God. How would you react to the following characterizations of God? He is a judging God. He will punish all sinners. He is so merciful. That means that he will overlook the sins of people. He loves the moral person, and so he reserves his hatred upon the wicked. We will be reading now from Exodus chapter 34, verse 5 to 8. The Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering, and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, by no means clearing the guilty. From our text, the background is that Moses pledged to know the Lord God who met him during his time. It was Yahweh who revealed himself to Moses. And so Moses was curious, and that was the background. This is the closest a man could get to a personal introduction by God of himself. How do you account for the apparent contrast or paradox in the characteristic? The text says keeping mercy, forgiving, versus by no means clearing the guilty. So our view of God's character is that it suggests that it is in relation to us should be seen in two clusters. Each is to be emphasized side by side with the other. First cluster. It is his nature to seek our good and establish personal relationship with us. So number one is he exercises special concern for those who are in misery because of sin, their sins, or other sins against them, both as sinners themselves and as victims of sins. Number two, from the text, we read that God is gracious and long-suffering. So it is not his first reaction to judge, but to be patient and to forbear, even to bless those who do not deserve any blessing. God being forgiving will lead to canceling our guilt and cleansing corruption, and that is the supreme act of his grace. What does this say to the idea? It says that God loves the morally righteous and hates the wicked. Do you think you are in need of God's mercy? If yes, why? A handful of denominations promote salvation by works. One of them is the Church of Jesus Christ in the Latter-day Saints, better known as the Mormons. Second is the Iglesia ni Cristo, or Church of Christ, and better known as the INC from the Philippines. Third among my list is the Members Church of God International, also known as ABD or Ang Tatintaan. It is a Tagalog byword for the title of their religious program in television and also in radio. They are also from the Philippines. The Mormons promote the belief that human beings get salvation both through the grace of God and their own action. According to them, part of the work of salvation has been done by the atonement of Jesus Christ, in that all human beings are guaranteed resurrection, but to attain the full quality of eternal life, human beings also have work to do. Now, with regard to the Iglesia Ni Cristo, they say that one must hear the gospel from authorized Iglesia Ni Cristo messengers and ministers, be a member of an Iglesia Ni Cristo church, and be water baptized to be saved. They strictly uphold that other names are not the true name of the church and, therefore, false churches. There you will be told to avoid eating dinuguan, that's the Tagalog word for bloody meat, avoid joining trade unions, avoid court sessions, among others. While the INC adhere to the doctrine that the founder Felix Manalo was the last messenger of God to rebuild the Church of Christ, the MCGI believe that their founder, Eliseo Soriano, is the only sensible preacher in our days. Everyone must enter the Church of God in the Bible as they did, and so they say. You must persevere to the end to get saved. This is done by obeying all the New Testament ordinances and laws. So we must be reminded that any idea of salvation by meritorious works is wrong, because it makes unnecessary the mercy of God. Now let's proceed to the second question. They are enveloped by the fact that God is holy and just. In the Bible, particularly in Habakkuk 1:13, it says this about God: "You are of pure eyes than to behold evil, and cannot look on wickedness. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in unrighteousness." As holy and just, He is repelled by every sin, however little it is regarded by man. Every sin calls for just punishment. While He exercises patience for the most part now, He will exact the fullness of judgment on the last day. Elohim, which is another name for God, which is also the plural, is holy and just. What can you say now? What does this say to the idea God will overlook our sins? What is your personal reaction to this character of God? Conclusion: God exercises love and mercy on sinners. This is grace, but He will mete out punishment on the unrepentant and unforgiven as His justice demands. And here is the challenge: you have to fear the justice of God. Plead God's mercy. And here are the supporting scriptures of our claim, which are namely God's love and mercy. We can find that out from reading Psalms 25 verse 10 and 1 John chapter 4 verse 8, jump to verse 16, among others, which prove that God's love is the very essence of God's character. Hosea chapter 3 verse 1 to 2 and John 3 verse 16 shows that love is the basis of God's saving acts. If you are to read Psalms chapter 103 verse 10 and chapter 130 verses 3 to 4, you will find that God does not presently deal with us in the way that our sinfulness really deserves. And this is what we call His mercy. The second part is God's holiness and justice. We can find that out from reading Psalm 93 verse 3, Hosea 11 verse 9, Psalm 24 verse 3, and Isaiah chapter 6, which tells us that holiness is the outstanding distinctive of God's character. Read Acts chapter 10 verses 3 to 4 and Romans chapter 2 verses 3 to 6, and you will find that As the just God, He is impartial in the execution of His laws. Psalm 5:4, Romans 2:16, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 10 to 11 are all saying that God will surely punish sin. And from there, we conclude our lesson. Thanks everyone